Good afternoon. My name is Chuck Morton, and I would like to welcome you on behalf of Venable to the second of a three-part series of webinars entitled Doing Government Contracting M&A Deals in Trying Times. This afternoon's discussion will focus on deal execution, and I'm joined today by my partner Karen Herman from Venable's corporate group, Paul DeBolt from our government contractings group, and our guest, Lidor DeRose, who's Senior Vice President of Transaction Liability Solutions with Lockton. Prior to joining Lockton, she had over a decade of experience as an M&A attorney and as an underwriter of transaction risk insurance. At Lockton, she helps clients with insurance solutions that mitigate the risk of M&A activity. And Dave West, who's Vice President of Corporate Development at ECS, where he evaluates merger and acquisitions and partnering opportunities and strategic partnerships and strategic planning expertise to help guide and communicate with the market and partners, investors, and other stakeholders of ECS. Prior to ECS, he worked as mergers and acquisition consultant and also at the U.S. Department of Homeland Security. We are pleased to have both of them and pleased to have you this afternoon join us. A couple of expectation setting points. First, our goal is for this to be a conversation, and as such, we are light on slides so that we don't get distracted in the slides. So hopefully you'll appreciate that. In addition, we invite questions throughout. The technology facilitates questions through the questions tab. Please feel free to raise questions. One of my jobs this afternoon will be to try to synthesize those questions. Where we can, we'll do our best to answer them just as part of the conversation, but we also intend to reserve some time at the end to drill down into some of the questions as well. And then finally, by way of disclaimer, the comments of the speakers today are just their own and don't necessarily represent the institutions where they work. So please just be appreciative of that. And finally, there will be a recording available of this, and we'll distribute a link to that recording once it is up on the web. So without more by way of introduction, let me invite Karen to pick up the baton and introduce today's topic. Karen?
Thanks, Chuck, and thank you all for joining us. We're very excited to have this conversation. I'll say at the outset, I've really enjoyed the prep sessions I've had with Lidor and Dave and have learned a lot. So I'm hoping we can translate some of that to you today. As Chuck said, this is the second of a three-part series. The first one, we talked about valuations and whether the pandemic, what impact the pandemic had had on valuations, particularly within the government contracts industry. I know a number of you joined for that call, so you might remember that at the end, the panelists started to get into process and how deals are actually getting done. Can things be done 100% virtually, et cetera? So that's where we pick up today. So we're going to talk with you guys for the next hour on sort of getting a deal done. What has changed? What's still the same? What do we think we can expect looking forward? I was asked to moderate this one because I closed four deals from my home office since this started. I'm pleased to say that a lot of it was familiar. Some things are different, but a lot of it was familiar. Still on hours and hours and hours of negotiation calls. One thing that was different is many of those calls were actually by video, whereas before it was just commonplace to have the negotiations be just by phone. Now it seems a lot of companies are pushing out for either networking connectivity, team building, whatever the point, pushing out trying to be on video. So I've actually, in some cases, got to see the faces of clients I work with for years and had never once been on a video call with them. So there's some good to come out of this. I also upgraded my printer. I now have a giant office-sized printer in my home office. It's getting quite a workout, I'll say. But otherwise, you know, the rest of it, I think a lot of it is still familiar. It's not a lot has changed. Diligence is still being done remotely through Merrill or Interlinks or any number of those online data sites. But one thing, so I started thinking about this kennel, like, so what saying to you it's all the same is not really news, right? So what has changed? And what we came up with is a series of things that we'll talk about on today's call, but we spent a lot more time focused on integration, I think, because it's harder to integrate cultures remotely. I would say the timeline has slowed down for some things. I think diligence seems to be taking longer, picking off deals seems to be taking longer, as it's harder to do that in a virtual environment. But the timeline sped up for other things. I feel like negotiations are actually being pushed forward quickly. So once an LOI has been signed, I felt like the negotiation timeline has been accelerated. I've got from LOI to closing or signing a lot faster. I think we have seen a small pickup at least so far of some more distressed deals, if you want to call them that. Maybe not true, Section 363 bankruptcy deals, but deals where companies are looking for cash or looking to sell off assets, the underperforming assets, to refocus on, core businesses. So I think we'll see a little bit more of that. I do think the diligence focus has shifted somewhat, and the rep and warranty insurance underwriting has changed. So that's why we've invited Dave West, Corp Dev, as Chuck said, to help us sort of think through the diligence and integration questions. Invited Lador, who's going to help us think through some of the rep and warranty questions. So let's dive in. I'm going to focus the first question to Paul DeBolt in our government contracts group. So Paul, buying a government contractor has always required significant level of diligence, a lot more diligence to buy a government contractor, I find, than just a commercial deal, more focus on the contracts themselves and much, much more focus on ethics and compliance issues. We've had in the past, and we could have hours of webinars on the hot diligence topics that come up in all government contracts deals. So while we'll cover maybe a little bit of that today, I want to focus you to think about what has changed. What's sort of new from your perspective? We're 4 months into this pandemic now. Are there areas of diligence focus that are new, or maybe some that are more important than ever before?
Well, I agree with you. Anytime you do a government contract deal, there's going to just be a higher level of due diligence. And I think that's arises because the government contract space is so highly regulated. You have a lot of people that are overseeing your business, the auditors, the IGs, the contracting officers. And then I think to your point about compliance, you always think back to that old adage by Oliver Wendell Holmes that men must turn square corners when they deal with the government. So I think that, a lot of what you've done in the past, worrying about audits or fraud or data rights or things like that, those are still there. I think probably the greatest unknown going forward at this point is going to be the impact of the CARES Act and a lot of the money that's been given to businesses pursuant to it, and how that's going to impact the due diligence and how it's going to potentially impact the risk that a potential purchaser or a seller could face. I was just going to talk a little bit about the Paycheck Protection Program, because that's gotten a lot of focus from DOJ, which I'll talk about in a minute. As many of you know, qualifying businesses apply to approved SBA lenders for loans up to 2.5 times their average monthly payroll, up to $10 million. The proceeds from those loans can be used for payroll costs, rent, utilities, interest on mortgage, other debt obligations that a company may have. And there's also the loan forgiveness component for funds used to pay payroll costs, rent, utilities, and interest on mortgage for the first 8 weeks after the loan originates. This isn't available to everybody. It's available to companies that have fewer than 500 employees. If a company has more than 500 employees but fewer than the employee size standard for the applicant's respective NAICS code, they would be eligible. If they don't have an employee size standard, it's going to be receipts-based. Are they qualified under, for engineering or something, maybe it's $37.5 million. And there's also an alternate size standard that the SBA has put in place. And I think the risk, you know, with especially the Payroll Protection Program is with regard to the certifications. And, you know, one of the certifications that has caused some concern is that, you know, when you take that money, you're representing that the uncertainty of the current economic conditions make necessary the loan request to support ongoing operations of the company. You know, we talked a little bit about what can be reimbursed. What can't be reimbursed is compensation of individual employees, independent contractors, or sole proprietors in excess of an annualized salary of, I believe it's $100,000. Compensation of employees with principal place of residence or outside the United States, and leave wages that are covered by the Families First Coronavirus Response Act. And I think it's important that a lot of these programs work in conjunction with one another. And, you know, the government is very focused on ensuring that companies don't double dip or receive more than what they should be entitled to. So I think that's another area that, you know, people should be concerned about. With regard to the guidance that's been issued, 75% of the amount forgiven must be used to cover payroll costs, and there could be some reductions to the amount of forgiveness if a company reduces the number of employees as compared to the prior year, if there's a reduction in pay of more than 25% as the last calendar year. So, I mean, there's lots of moving parts in the context of the program. Now, I mean, one of the things that you'll see or heard, you know, there have been a number of cases that have already been reported throughout the country where Department of Justice is going after people that they feel have taken advantage of the Payroll Protection Program. There was a speech given by the Deputy Assistant Attorney General, Ethan Davis, to the U.S. Chamber of Commerce Institute for Legal Reform. And during that speech, I think it was in the latter part of June, he made it abundantly clear that the government, and I'll quote what he said, the government will energetically use every enforcement tool available to prevent wrongdoers from exploiting the COVID-19 crisis. And one of the programs that he singled out in the context of his speech was the Paycheck Protection Program. And I just think it's just a function of the fact that when this much money has been injected into the economy at a given time, it certainly creates a number of opportunities for fraud allegations. So the bad news is that DOJ is going to be looking at this. The SBA is going to be looking at this. It's going to get a lot of focus going forward. Now, with regard, you know, so that's the bad news. I mean, there is some good news in what's coming out of DOJ. There have been a number of assistant U.S. attorneys throughout the country that have talked about, you know, CARES Act money and what they see on the horizon for enforcement. DOJ has made the statement, a number of AUSAs have made the statement that DOJ is not going to pursue companies that made immaterial or inadvertent technical mistakes in processing paperwork or that simply misunderstood the rules, terms, conditions, or certification requirements. And with the way this program has evolved, you know, there's certainly any number of inadvertent mistakes that could occur. I mean, you know, what they've said is that they're really going to focus on those borrowers, those companies that knowingly failed to comply with material legal obligations and certifications. So I think in the context of due diligence as it relates to CARES Act money, it's going to be important for a potential buyer to be able to identify when a mistake was material or inadvertent or when it was made knowingly. And that may sound like a relatively simple analysis, And the things that that the complicates that analysis is that in the context of a Civil False Claims Act action by the government does not have to prove intent to defraud. The Civil False Claims Act defines knowing and knowingly as, you know, if you had actual knowledge that the information was false, if you acted in deliberate ignorance of the truth or falsity of the information, or you acted in reckless disregard of the truth or falsity of the information. And when the government looks at that, you know, they're really looking at aggravated gross negligence plus, or, you know, maybe an extreme version of ordinary negligence. So the fact that the government is saying, oh, well, we're only looking for people that knowingly failed to do this, the fact is that that knowledge requirement isn't the typical criminal scanner that you would think of. So one of the things that I did want to correct is that on some of the most recent revisions to the payroll protection plan, the payroll requirement's been reduced to 60% from 75%. So that's going to provide some benefit to people. So, I mean, if I was on the outside looking in and trying to figure out what risk that could arise from companies taking this money, I mean, I think you're really going to have to focus on the documentation that is available within the company. I mean, is there documentation that supports the conclusion that the loan was necessary to support the ongoing operations of the company? Did the company have access to other capital? I mean, did they document that lack of access? Are there documents that indicate or discuss the anticipated impact on staffing if they hadn't actually taken the money? You know, what does the company have contemporaneously that reflects their analysis about why, you know, they took the money? Was this discussed at the board level? Are there minutes of board meetings where this was discussed and the need was discussed? You know, were those approved by the board? You know, at what level in the company were, you know, was this decision approved? You know, do they have the application? Is it complete? You know, do they have the documentation that supports the numbers that they're requesting? Did they actually have the number of employees they represented? Because a lot of times in the cases that you're seeing now that are being reported in the media, you know, people have either inflated the number of employees that are on their payroll. There have been situations where companies have created shell companies and indicated that they had a payroll of X number of million of dollars when actually they don't have any employees. So you didn't really need to be mindful of what representations were made. To the extent the company received funds, have they segregated the loan proceeds? Can they show where the money was used? You know, was it used for one of the authorized purposes?
I'm revising our buyer side due diligence checklist right now as you talk. That's a.
I mean, these are some of the things I would think about. You know, did the company take other CARES Act money? You know, and how they accounted for that? Have they trued it up to make sure there wasn't any sort of double recovery by the company? I mean, those would sort of be the things that I think going in that I'd want to do some kicking of the tires on. You know, I mean, hopefully the documentation is contemporaneous. As we all know, that's going to be better documentation, the documentation that was prepared after the fact. But I think just as an initial working list, you know, given that the situation is still relatively fluid, although not as fluid as it was, that, you know, these would be some of the things that would probably be keeping me up at night.
That's very helpful, and we'll definitely be including you anytime we look at a company that has a PPP loan going forward. But what I mean, I recall back in the last financial crisis in 2008-2009, sort of seeing after that kind of a heightened risk of whistleblowers, you know, kind of the unhappy employee that got laid off and trying to just challenge that because there's morale issues, et cetera, when this employee comps getting cut, people are being laid off, positions are being eliminated. So do you anticipate seeing any of that, or do you think that that won't be the case this time?
I mean, I think it's always a risk. I think that if you look back historically, any time that there's a lot of money that goes into the system, you know, there's increased scrutiny by the government. You know, you can think of the war over in Iraq. You can think of Katrina, TARP. I mean, there have been any number of instances where there's been a huge inflow of money into the economy. You know, then the auditors come through and they have perfect 2020 hindsight, you know, really not appreciating sort of what the reality was on the ground when you got your money. And I also think that, you know, there is an increase that, you know, people that are either disgruntled or have been let go, you know, some people just feel they have a moral obligation to raise their hand. I mean, it certainly isn't uncommon when an employee is terminated from his job or her job that they get an employment attorney to write a letter to the company complaining about the severance package that's been offered the employee, and then including at the end of the letter, oh, by the way, you know, Sally or Jimmy is aware of some financial improprieties in your company. We really don't want to make an issue out of this, but it would be really helpful if instead of 3 months severance, you give me 6 months. And, you know, that sort of offer creates a whole host of different problems that are outside of our discussion today. But I think that to the extent people are let go after this crisis passed, or, you know, those types of letters are going to find their ways to company and present some risk. I mean, it's not as clear to me what motivates people to level these claims. I think that there is a not insignificant portion of people that level these allegations because they really don't have a full appreciation of the facts in a given situation or a complete understanding of the applicable laws or regulations. They just have a gut feeling that something's wrong. And given the complexity of, you know, the payroll protection program and these issues and what they're seeing in the media, I mean, certainly a lack of understanding could motivate people to do it. Some people just do it for the money. If you're a key camera later, you know, you're going to be entitled to some level of the share, whatever the government gets in its recovery. I think the last time I checked, it was between 15 and 25%, which is, you know, it's not a bad payday. You know, some people are having job performance problems and they want to obtain whistleblower status so that they can fend off any adverse employment action, because if you're a whistleblower, you're protected status, you can't be retaliated against. And again, as I mentioned, I think that some people just do this because they think it's the right thing to do. You know, they have some fundamental issue with the way that the government or the government or the company has handled things. I mean, what you will see is that if you even conduct the simplest internet search right now, there are a number of advertisements for QTAM plaintiffs' lawyers specifically related to situations where a company has received payroll protection program funds. And I mean, it's kind of interesting to look at, you know, where it's like, did your employer get payroll protection funds? Do you think they were entitled to it? If no, call me and we can sue. I mean, it's really almost like, you know, that blatant. I mean, and some of the things that those attorneys seem to be pushing or areas that they seem to want to collect facts on for the potential lawsuits deal with company eligibility, you know, whether or not the company was eligible for PPP money. You know, did they misrepresent its payroll, a number of employees? You know, did they misrepresent something in the initial certification to get the loan in the first place? And then at the back end, did they misrepresent something regarding how they used the money to get the loan forgiveness? Some of the other areas that come up in these on these websites are deal with whether a company actually laid off employees, but still, you know, collected for them, whether the company had access to other funds. And there are a lot of first-line employees that aren't going to have this information, but a lot of times the ones that are most dangerous to a company are the ones that have, you know, sort of the least insight into how the company's run. You know, they're just, you know, they're kind of like Mel Gibson in Conspiracy Theory. You kind of wonder if some of these folks are sitting around their apartment with tinfoil, you know, lining it.
Yeah, so Dave, if Paul hasn't scared you away from doing deals right now, let's step aside for a second from the legal diligence and talk a little about, from your perspective, if anything has changed in the due diligence of a company. So in your role as the corporate development, looking at companies, financials, et cetera, what do you see anything that's changed from your perspective in diligence? What would you be looking at now that might be different?
Yeah, thanks, Karen, and thanks to everybody for carving out time to join this discussion. You know, I think it's an era now where you could potentially let 1,000 uncertainty flowers bloom. And as someone who helps look over all of ASGN and kind of our, you know, we've got a big exposure of the government sector, obviously, but also financial services, technology. You know, GovCon is kind of a relatively calm port in the storm, so to speak. But within our area, you know, we're trying to kind of disaggregate, you know, the risks that we can quantify with really keeping the eye on the ball of where we're trying to reposition our business overall. So I think not a ton of changes. I do focus more now a bit on, you know, there is a little bit of, you know, kind of budget funding risk. You know, as we're looking at a lot of companies that are at inflection points in their growth and they're growing quickly. And so we are digging further into, you know, really how quickly are they able to ramp up on new programs. You know, we are seeing a little bit of friction and being able to kick off new wins and really, you know, there's some clearance issues still. So just the blocking and tackling of actually making that pipeline and backlog that's advertised in the financials a reality and getting into the details on, you know, is the velocity and momentum there that we hope and think is there. So we're digging in there. You know, on the reopening process, I think it's, We've always tried to be really kind of a speed and certainty buyer, try to differentiate in the deal process. It's very hard to do. There's a lot of great companies out there competing with us. And so, you know, we're in the buzzword spaces of AI and machine learning and DevSecOps. And so a bit of a mixed martial arts fight to get and retain this talent. So you're trying to move quickly, you know, but in this market, you know, that reopening process, the COVID protocols, you know, I think it's something that we do want to dig into. You know, how were they able to close remotely their back office? How are they looking at, you know, taking care of their employees and working with their customers? How has that kind of back and forth pitch and catch been? I know we're working very hard on that just ourselves, so we don't want to be too rigid, but you want to see, you know, how are they, you know, codifying, how are they communicating and executing on that? You know, at the same time, it's a moving target, right? We've had national security customers reach out to us, you know, help them think through how they're going to do it with their own government employees. So a little bit more focus on some of those kind of human elements and the process element just to make sure you're not, you know, opting into risks that you're not clearly thinking through. But we're trying to keep our eye on the strategic prize, you know, at the same time.
Understood. So Lindor, some of these risks that Paul identified and went through earlier, some of the compliance risks, you know, will be covered, I'm sure, as we start to get deeper into this and we see purchase agreements with more and more and more detailed reps and warranties about this. I always think M&A lawyers suffer from some level of PTSD, where if you've ever been, been burned on one point once, that the merger agreement going forward is always going to have that provision in your perspective. And then there's the combined PTSD of the M&A bar that makes the reps and warranties go from 15 pages to 30. So I'm expecting to see quite a lot of, you know, new reps and sort of the market movement. We're starting to see them already. And Chuck was just telling us, he can jump in here too, about some deals he's doing where he's seeing it even kind of at the LOI stage. So rep and warranty insurance, when I first started doing government contracts deals back in the dark ages, really wasn't available for government contractors. The underwriters were scared of it. They just kind of said when I would call the brokers, I would get the response, yeah, I don't think so. But that's not the case anymore. I mean, it's now becoming, if not commonplace, it's very common now, if it's not sort of just across the board. But do you think that the change circumstances here are going to change that trend, or do you see that staying the same?
No, I don't think that this current economic situation that we're in should change that at all. As you said, at first, rep and warranty insurers were a little bit leery of the government contract space because of the high level of compliance and other types of items that are done. But conversely, what they learned to recognize, and Paul spoke to this earlier, is that there is such a high level of diligence that's done in this space. And there's a lot of smart lawyers really digging in the issues and understanding what has happened to date with the target. And the insurers have engaged outside counsel to help them understand those government contract specific issues and get comfortable with them. And we have no resistance in the market to getting policies done on these deals. The one concern, of course, on everyone's mind is, how is COVID-19 affecting a target's business? How is it affecting the customers, the suppliers, the employees? And to that extent, we have seen in the last few months generally in the market, most insurers have looked to include a pretty broad exclusion in the policy for any of the impacts of COVID-19. They are starting to try to get a little bit more comfortable and smart about it as the situation evolves and we see a little bit more how everything is unfolding, how people are dealing with this. There is more of an effort to tailor those exclusions or to try to get comfortable with them in certain spaces if they're really not applicable. For example, if you have a business that's very much an IT-based business in the government space with government clients where demand hasn't diminished and everybody is working from home and there's no types of issues, you certainly have a strong argument that a COVID-19 exclusion in that case is not applicable. The rep and warranty policy will not respond to any reps around COVID, including around receipt of CARES Act funding or PPP loans. Those are all excluded from the policies. But other than that, it's very much business as usual with respect to rep and warranty insurance.
That's good news. I've got a deal that's closing the end of the month, and I've got the underwriting bring down call. Went through a long antitrust review, so it's been quite a long time since we talked to the underwriters at signing. And there's 5 pages of questions that they've sent us to prep. You know, questions 2 through 10 are half a page on page 5, and they're the questions I've seen over and over and over again, the same bring down questions they always ask at closing. But pages 1 through 4.5 are all questions 1A through whatever, that all about COVID. So I can see, and in that deal, it's really interesting because it's an asset deal, no employees coming over. We're literally just trying to get patents and trademarks is really what we're buying in that deal. So a lot of the questions they've asked don't even make a lot of sense. I'm sure we'll have a fun time on that bring down call. But I think it is just showing how the market is trying to come to terms with what the risks are and what risks they should be concerned about, and that they have been, the insurer and the underwriter have been, you know, working with us in responsive to our responses to those questions by narrowing the exclusions. And so I feel like we're going to be in a good place by the end of the month, but it has been an interesting, much different experience than typical when that was just the 20-minute, almost a check-the-box call.
Yes, we used to get those bring down calls done maybe even in 10 minutes, but these days it's certainly a much longer experience that we have to, and we work with our clients to prepare them for these calls. Really the point of what they're trying to do there is to flesh out any true interim breaches that occurred as a result of coronavirus, because they don't want the policy to be responding to those type of issues. So to the extent that there has been an impact to the company, to the assets you're purchasing in your case, that's the type of thing that they don't want to be on the hook for, hence the need for more of a 45-minute or an hour-long bring-down call.
Yeah, agreed. if they're excluding all the PPP loans stuff, what are they excluding anything else? Like, what about False Claims Act claims. Do you see exclusions around that, or is that generally covered?
That's definitely something that they will want to make sure has been diligenced during the process, and that there's no types of history of those types of issues in the target company. But unless you have a situation where there has been concerns in the past, it's something that we would expect the policy to respond to. In the same way that the policy will respond to any claims that the buyer has against a seller for seller fraud, they will, False Claims Act is fraud against the government. So it would be included in something that the policy would respond to.
Subject, I guess, to the normal subrogation against the seller restrictions.
Correct.
That you see.
That's right. The insurer will only retain rights to subrogate against the seller in the case of fraud. They otherwise do not have the right to go against seller, which is one of the reasons why sellers are typically quite comfortable with having these policies as well. They're not on the hook for any type of indemnification claim that gets paid out by the policy. It's just in the case of fraud.
Right, exactly. And then I think, and the buyers, and the reason for this becoming more and more commonplace in my view is because government contracts risks, the ones that Paul identified at least, are sometimes don't come out in the first 18 months. Mm-hmm. After closing, you don't necessarily get a claim while you might still have an escrow against from a seller in a more traditional approach. So in these rep and warranty policies, at least the ones I negotiate usually have a six-year term or long. It can have any number of years, right? But often my clients buy 5 or 6 year terms so that in case claims come in after the 18 months, which is the typical rep and warranty survival period, they still have some sort of a recourse.
Yeah, the standard policy period for these policies is to cover breaches of general reps or the operational reps for a period of 3 years and fundamental and tax reps for 6 years. There is some availability in the market on a case-by-case basis and for additional premium to get all reps covered for 6 years, but it's not typically common. And the claims experience, the way it's borne out, is typically the 3 years on the operational claims is sufficient. We do see claims coming in after that 12 to 18 month mark. There's still typically after 18 months, 20 to 25% of the claims that still come in, particularly with respect to third party litigation or audits or things like that. So there is definitely value to still having that policy for the additional 18 months of coverage or 24 months of coverage that you would get as opposed to the purchase agreement indemnification.
Right, for sure. So if there's a history, you said that they don't cover, would rather not cover things if there's a history of problems that could arise in diligence. Paul, when you look at a company, what sort of things do you diligence to see whether there's a history of problems that might be excluded, False Claims Act or otherwise?
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the things you want to see is, whether a company's made any mandatory disclosures under 52-203-13, where, they have to go to the contracting officer if there's been a significant overpayment or if there's been a fraud, Civil False Claims Act, or some 18 USC violation, they have to go to the IG. A lot of companies don't file those because I think that, it can cause a whole other set of problems, not the least of which is getting a letter from the suspension and debarment official about, why you need to show cause that you should continue to be a government contractor. But, I think I'd be concerned if there's a company that's, filing a lot of significant mandatory disclosures, every month or every 6 months or something like that. I'd be concerned about it. Now, having said that, there are companies that, given the concern that the government's not quite sure what's fraud and what's not, they sort of disclose everything. And like every quarter, they'll send in an Excel spreadsheet that just says, hey, look, here's everything that happened. We don't think there's a problem. Let us know. And so I think you have to look at each company and look at the nature of the disclosures that occurred. I think you want to look at, sort of the training that happens. Is it actual training? Is there a culture of compliance or is the compliance program just in a book that's on a shelf? You know, what type of calls do they get to their hotline, you know, to the extent that they that they have one? I know some companies, when an employee leaves, you know, as part of their exit interview, you know, they have to certify that, you know, they're not aware of any fraud that's occurred, you know, during their tenure. And not that that's a get out of jail free card, but, you know, it certainly gives me some comfort that, you know, when employees are leaving and, you know, might be more likely to identify that there's been some sort of problem that they don't, you know. So I really do think you just need to sort of kick the tires on the whole entire compliance program, you know, to figure out if a company really does have a culture of compliance, because it's so fundamental to, you know, being a successful government contractor.
Agreed. So Dave, you know, that brings us back a little bit to diligence again. It makes me think about this. Paul says culture of compliance, sort of how do you diligence culture, especially now where we're living in mostly a virtual remote reality? I mean, can you imagine or contemplate, you know, completing a deal diligence process from start to finish without meeting the team? I mean, how are you thinking about diligencing culture generally?
Yeah, I think it's obviously challenging. I know on our prep call, I was thinking back to the last physical data room I was in. I was at Morgan Stanley in New York, and there must have been a telegraph machine in there, you know, a speakeasy across the hallway. You know, I think we're accustomed to doing a lot of due diligence remotely and virtually. And we've had good success. I think we can get most of the way there. You know, I think we've been focusing on kind of as many video calls and discussions as possible, as early as possible, kind of persistently throughout the process. You know, I was a consultant before this. I was at Wolf Den Associates, and, you know, you're constantly meeting with management teams of all sizes, and you can really feel across the table, you know, if the culture is real or if it's just bullet points on some slides or on a website. We're getting a good feel over the, you know, the technology is so much more advanced than post 9/11, where we had kind of a tsunami of that attack. This is more of a flood that's going to last, and I think people are adjusting. You know, we've had good ability to read culture and fit, but I think at some point you're going to want to get in the room with someone and with the team. And so, you know, we just have to monitor the protocols and do what buyers and sellers are comfortable with. But I think there's still going to be that, you know, that social element, and you're going to need to get face to face, you know, at certain points here.
I think that's probably true. It goes both ways too, correct? It's not just from the buyers wanting to meet the sellers. I'm hearing from some sell side companies we're talking to that, you know, they, especially the management team, want to be able to meet their new boss, you know, make sure that they like the guy before they sign up to give up their autonomy in the company that they've built to go work for somebody else. So it will be.
Yeah, I agree with that. Yeah, even just, you know, from our perspective, you know, we are, you know, we love our acronyms, right? We are ECS owned by ASGN, and it's a special company with, I think, a very genuine culture. But, you know, we can assert that, hey, we're at the scale and capabilities of a large, but we're quicker and we're nimble, you know, kind of. But that's just it's easy to say that. And so it's on us to really get face-to-face, either via video or persistently in person, carefully, to make that case and really show these sellers that, hey, you know, they really know how to integrate, they know how to grow businesses, and we can trust what they're saying. So yeah, it's as much in our selfish interest to do it than it is just for the process.
I see that. Yeah, interesting. So shifting gears for a minute, just sort of thinking about what else has changed in the executing deals and the new normal here. One of the things that I think we may see in the coming months or years is more carve-out type deals, whether people are just selling off individual assets or carving out non-core businesses. Or maybe there will even be some true distressed deals, bankruptcy, Section 363 type deals coming our way. Those deals are often structured as asset deals. So I just wanted to ask Paul, we see some, we usually avoid doing asset deals as much as we can in the government contracts arena because we don't want to have to deal with the novation process, the Anti-Assignment Act issues that come up for prime contracts. Are you seeing any changes with the novation process since the pandemic started? I mean, I saw one good one, which is that DCMA issued a press release that they're no longer requiring corporate seals, because I guess the seal was at the office and the people were signing it from home. So I found, personally, I felt very good about that because digging up that corporate seal from years ago to get a novation package, and it's always been an annoying part of our job. But is there anything that you've seen, Paul?
I mean, other than just that, even under the best of circumstances, novations are slow. But I think they're even slower now with people working, you know, remotely, with so many other things coming across a contracting officer's desk. I mean, I have two or three novation packages that have been sitting at, you know, various agencies for 7 months now. And, you know, when the client or when the purchaser or the seller calls over, you know, do you guys need anything? Is everything fine? Is there more information? You know, the response is, you know, typically that, you know, we're working on it. I think the other thing I've seen a couple instances of this year, which I was trying to think back to when I'd seen it before, but I am seeing situations where the contracting officer won't approve a novation. And, you know, where you're sort of seeing that is in the context of, you know, some large IDIQ vehicle that maybe a company hasn't used or monetized it in the way they thought they were going to. So they're looking to get some money, to make some money off of it and try to give somebody else a fishing license. And I've had a couple instances where contracting officers have not agreed to novate those vehicles because they thought that, you know, the other schedule holders would provide them with enough, or another IDIQ holders would provide them with enough competition. So that was something that, you know, I hadn't seen much over the course of my career.
And Dave, in our prep call, Dave, you mentioned that too is something that you're seeing a little bit more of.
Yes, yeah, that's right.
Lador, can a buyer purchase rep and warranty insurance for an asset transaction or a carve-out deal like this?
Yes, absolutely. They can be purchased for carve-out deals, whether they're asset purchases or a stock purchase of a subsidiary from a larger company. They can be purchased for distressed deals, particularly useful in those situations because oftentimes the seller is not available to stand behind the indemnity that they're providing, and they can even be used in true bankruptcy 363 transactions. The importance is always to have diligence done that's sufficient to support the reps that are being given by the seller. But rep and warranty insurance is available in all of these situations. I would say in the carve-out situation in particular, there's a big emphasis on understanding the financials of the carved-out entity or the carved-out assets and whether add-backs and things and additional support that will be needed to added to the carved-out entity going forward and how all of that works. So the importance of doing a robust quality of earnings report on those type of deals is essential, although it's quite important to any deal where rep and warranty insurance is being used.
Just to echo that, you know, I think our most recent transaction was an asset transaction, and you know, reps and warranty insurance was used, and I can attest that despite these long, you know, check down calls, Lidor can be very helpful in preparing the team you know, it's definitely was helpful in kind of executing our process.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about that. You said you had recently managed an asset acquisition. Are there any other tips or best practices that you would be willing to share?
Yeah, I think just echoing some of the points that have been made, I think making sure there's, you know, enough diligence around the carved out entity and really, you know, in our environment, you know, given the nature of Blackstone Federal was the latest deal that we did, you know, there's really just no chance, there's really a high risk of any sort of minor hiccup, you know, upon transition, because immediately, you know, all these talented people become our employees. So I think just really focusing, you know, getting a really organized team, both from a diligence perspective, but also an integration perspective, and making sure, you know, all of your back office processes are ready, and really kind of focusing diligence and integration as kind of one effort. You know, we knew even exactly how many parking spots they were going to need and where they were located. And, you know, on the novation process, the company was going through had recently won a recompete, but, you know, a lot of these task orders were going to move over. So I think it's really getting into the depths of it as soon as possible, so that there are no surprises, you know, kind of as soon as that light switch is flipped and, you know, this is now part of your business. So, and then working closely with obviously Lidor or, you know, a team on the reps and warranty side, to making sure that's a very fluid, it's a smooth process.
Yeah, that point about integration is an interesting one to me. That's what I think potentially is the hardest thing to accomplish in this environment, this new normal environment we're in. I mean, M&A deals are only as good as how well you're able to integrate the company, and it's long been a focus of the corporate development teams. And even I have clients who start the integration team calls the same day we start the diligence, you know, the same week we start the weekly diligence calls, just to get, because it's so important. But how are you thinking, Dave, about integrating either a business unit or a company that you've just bought, new employees that are coming in? I mean, what we have typically seen is sort of the elaborate day one parties where the new management team flies in and there's T-shirts and iPhone cases or balloons, whatever, company picnics, offsite retreats. Now, even with some companies that are back to the office, we're still dealing with a physically distanced office space. So the water cooler conversations, the casual hallway conversations are going to be a little more stilted if they're available even at all. So have you guys started thinking about that and integrating the acquired company?
Yeah, we have, and I think it is a challenge. You know, we are probably about 3,100 employees or so now, and you know, it's hard enough to integrate and keep, you know, as a really cohesive unit, our own people. And so we're obviously, every company is focused on this all the time. But from an acquisition perspective, you know, I think that all hands meeting and the swag and really the, you know, that coming together is still vital. You know, I think it may, you know, it's likely to be just many, you know, additional smaller meetings. And so just the investment of management time, I think, just needs to be even more so focused on this, where you're meeting with small groups of people in a safe manner, or it's video calls, and it's just rinse, repeat, and you've got to get that, you know, the key points across, right? Whether it's about, you know, benefits, you know, hey, can I keep my doctor, to, hey, this is the strategic value of the deal. I think it's going to be just much more hands-on, even if it's remote. It's going to be smaller groups, more meetings, more repetition, and you've got to show the culture and that it's real. Through consistent contact on that. I think it's, you know, our sector, you know, a lot of people love the mission, a lot of people love the customer. And so, you know, it's hard to differentiate in an IT solutions business meaningfully. So tiny differences matter a lot. And I think it's just, you know, there's thin margin for error anyway. And this is in this market, it's going to be even more important and kind of, I guess, risky for anybody to not be really careful and thorough in how they do it.
I think that's right. And what about employee training? I know when companies merge, there's a new code of conduct that the new employees have to learn. There's new policies, even just time entry policies, how to fill out expense reports, entertainment expense policies. Paul, do you have any tips or best practices for companies that are thinking about onboarding employees as to how to do that training, virtual or remotely, perhaps?
Yeah, I mean, I think that until things get back to normal, it's all going to have to be done online. You know, and I think a lot of the clients that we deal with in the services space, I mean, sort of the annual refresher training and, you know, the annual certifications that employees have to make, I mean, that's mostly done online now, too. I mean, I can think of a few companies that still would do it live, but a lot of it's just just done online. I mean, obviously, I mean, it's important to do it sooner rather than later, because you want to make sure that, you know, people are adhering to the policies, and, you know, especially timekeeping and some of those other things. But, you know, I just don't have a good sense as to when, you know, you'll get back to the live interaction, which I think is important. But, I mean, I think virtual is going to be the way to go for probably, you know, at least another 6 to 8 months.
I think that's right. So that kind of brings me to the end of my questions. I don't know, Chuck, if you had other questions for the panelists that are coming out of this, or if the audience wants to pipe up with some questions. We've seen a couple come in. We can go back to you. But...
yeah, why don't we be certain that we answer the questions that the audience has asked. So, for example, one of our attendees has asked, is there any formal documentation about the corporate seal no longer being required? In other words, where can they find that announcement?
Yeah, I'm going to have to look for that. I saw it come through. I know a bunch of us emailed it around. I'll have to look for that, and I can make that available. Maybe while you ask the next question, I can even see if I can find it really quickly online.
Sure. Yeah, and the next question really goes to the incentives behind whistleblowers. And Paul, why don't we direct this question to you, as you spoke about this and what the various motivations may be for someone doing that?
Yeah, and again, I mean, every individual is different, but, you know, to the extent that a current or former employee becomes a QTAM relator, which essentially QTAM means they stand in the king's shoes, so they have the ability to sue on behalf of the government to recover for potential fraud that was committed by a contractor. I mean, those get filed under seal. You may not know for some period of time that there's a suit that's out there. You know, the government can make a decision whether to intervene in that suit or not. The government also has the ability to seek to dismiss a QTAM case. That's become more frequent, but if they don't seek to dismiss it, or if they decide to intervene, you know, at some point you're going to become aware that, you know, you have a disgruntled employee or a former employee that's filed a suit against you because of purported fraud. And, you know, there is some incentive for it, because depending on, you know, how the case proceeds, they're going to get some percentage of the recovery. And, you know, the damages that are available under the Civil False Claims Act are significant. You know, one of the biggest hammers the government has is that when they recover for fraud under the Civil False Claims Act, they can get three times whatever the damages are, treble damages. So let's say that you fraudulently filled out an application, you got $1 million loan, the government takes the position, you know, that the fraud was material to you getting the loan, and but for that fraud, they wouldn't have given you the $1 million. Now you're potentially on the hook for three. And then, you know, if the relator is going to get, you know, 15% of that, you know, they're looking at $450,000 in their pocket. And a lot of the attorneys that do this type of action do it on contingent fee. I mean, there's a whole plaintiff's bar that's out there that does nothing to pursue these causes of action. It's difficult to say, you know, how significant a risk it is to any given business, but certainly in the current environment with the amount of money that's flowing through the system, with, you know, the lack of clarity on what the rules are, an employee's lack of understanding regarding what the rules are or what your company did, I can't say the risk is zero. I mean, you certainly can't live in fear that it's going to happen, but certainly if you get wind of these concerns, or an employee expresses a concern about what your business has done, you really do need to take it seriously. I mean, a lot of people that file these actions, you know, feel that their concerns weren't adequately addressed when they raised them through the appropriate management channels. So to the extent that something like this did arise, you know, I would take it seriously and, you know, do the due diligence that's necessary to make sure there's not a problem.
Dave, how about one question for you, which is, I think that one of the reasons why I at least am bullish on the near and intermediate term in the government contracting space is because of the sense that this may be a sector that is a little less vulnerable to the economic turmoil caused by the pandemic. Do you think that is true? In other words, that it's less vulnerable? And assuming that's true, what do you expect the market to be like as PE funds and other folks are looking to deploy money where they think there still may be opportunities?
Yeah, thanks for that question. I agree with that. I'm a bit biased just because we've been, living in this acronym soup for so long as we have. But being part of a broad public company that has exposure to a lot of sectors, we're in over 350 of the Fortune 500. Just the long-term nature of the contracts, the revenue visibility, and frankly, unfortunately, humanity is not perfecting itself. We've got state actors, non-state actors, pandemics. There's just a huge amount of government missions that need to be executed, and just a huge pent-up demand for IT system modernization and just transformation of how the government operates. Against the backdrop of an aging government workforce that can't execute and doesn't have the technology on the inside that it needs. So I think huge kind of macro support for a vibrant sector for the for the long term, but also for the near term. A little bit concerned about, we're in a very unique situation here where good chance that the Department of Defense or the sector in general may have to be a bit of a bill payer at some point for the trillions that are being spent necessarily, to combat the pandemic. So I do think opportunities are going to be plentiful. But I know we're thinking about, that maybe a year or two from now, I think we need to make sure that we need to stay lean and get lean and be able to, I think it's going to get more competitive here before too long. I remember in 1999, reading an article about, is the business cycle dead? And obviously it wasn't. So I think this up market is not going to last forever. So you need to make sure you're building a resilient and pretty lean, it's a competitive space, but I agree that it's going to remain, really stable and attractive.
And Lidor, are you witnessing from your front row seat on the deal community a higher percentage of deals in the government contracting space than historical? If so, do you anticipate that trend continuing or at some point pent-up demand for other deals that have just locked up actually resurging?
Yes, we definitely see an increase in these types of deals and other types of very stable industries in the current economy, like infrastructure. We're obviously not seeing anything in very consumer-facing businesses like restaurants or retail or hotels. I think government contracts is one of those spaces right now that's seen as a very safe investment, and smart companies like David ECS and other folks out there, PE funds that are looking to buy, are taking advantage of the current market and maybe some decreased multiples in the market to make smart acquisitions. Deals in this space are definitely still getting done.
Do you perceive there to be risk, Lidor, for folks who have not historically been in the government contracting arena, moving into the arena for the first time? And if so, what would be some things that you would particularly caution them about?
I think there's certainly always some level of risk in moving to a space that you haven't historically invested in. But as long as you engage, and it may sound a little self-serving, but as long as you engage advisors that are very smart in the space, lawyers like Paul and Karen who really understand these businesses and can really diligence all the risks, and financial advisors similarly, and to the extent that you want to use a rep and warranty policy to make sure that you have a solid indemnification for any unknown risks and breaches of the reps, you want to make sure that you're engaging folks that have experience in these spaces and that have done this deal after deal and really understand how to advise you and all the risks and not get tripped up on small issues or things that will be red herrings in the space.
Terrific. And Dave, I guess the same question to you. Are you starting to see players who you've not historically seen move into the space?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, for example, my parent company, ASGN, was a, mostly commercially facing business and has entered in the last few years to really access, this big, high-end resilient market. And I think they're just talking with other friends that are at generalist private equity funds, searching for, good high risk adjusted returns. I do see, some new entrants and, doubling down of existing really strong players. I think there's natural ebb and flow to kind of, there's certainly kind of quote unquote tourists entering and leaving at certain parts of the cycles, but this is such a huge market and there's so many kind of positive attributes to it. I think there's a core cadre of kind of serial investors and company growers, and then there's I think a pretty broad debt, equity, and other investors that see a lot of those good attributes too.
That's probably a perfect segue in the absence of other questions from our audience to remind you that 2 weeks from today on July 28th, we will be having the third part and final part of our series, Doing Government Contracting M&A Deals in Trying Times. That third part will focus on financing deals in today's economy, government contracting deals specifically. I'd like to take a moment to again thank Lidore DeRose, Senior Vice President of Transaction Liability Solutions at Lockton, Dave West, Vice President of Corporate Development at ECS, and my partners, Paul DeBolt and Karen Herman, for an informative and entertaining discussion. Hopefully you've enjoyed it as much as I have. Thank you for your attention. And again, look for the upcoming invitation to the last of this series. And with that, let me say thank you to all.